Clubhouse is a new destination for Wall Street and Silicon Valley insiders.
The voice chat app that is all the rage right now.
The next big media platform.
I don't f***ing get Clubhouse. We're doing Clubhouse here. I don't f***ing get it.
Clubhouse is the hottest new social media app, but as noted in this thread on Twitter, it may have a problem on its hands.
And that problem is an interestingness problem. Is interestingness a word?
It is now.
Basically, suggesting that when a new platform like this arises, people flood to it and start creating content. But it's kind of hard to figure out if any of it is actually good, interesting. What do you do once you get into the app? How do you solve this?
Today on the show, we're going to be speaking with some breakout creators on the platform that seem to be solving that problem.
We had a great conversation with the girls who run NYU Girls Roasting Tech Guys, which is a hit show on Clubhouse. And we talked to them about the good, the bad, and the future of Clubhouse.
In just about a month, they've had crazy growth, huge collabs, and have already worked with brand partners.
So today's episode is a lesson for all creators in what the future of building an audience looks like. But it's also a lesson for platforms on how they can ensure their app does not go down in flames like Quibi.
You know what happened with Quibi.
We all know what happened with Quibi. And if you've been liking the show, the way you can support it is by subscribing to the channel. And if you're already subscribed to the channel, the way you can support us is by liking the video.
Colin, Samir, roll the intro.
That's not my job.
Samir, roll the intro.
It's not my job, Colin.
Okay. Whoa. All right. I'll roll the intro.
Roll the intro. All right. We want to take a second to thank the sponsor for this episode, Aura Ring. Colin, I have a question for you.
Hit me.
How much sleep did I get last night?
Why would I know that?
Guess.
8 hours.
Incorrect. 7 hours and 39 minutes. And
pretty close, actually. So.
Well, Colin, my heart rate was 46 beats per minute. How do I know all of this? It's because I've been wearing this Aura Ring. Now, Aura Ring records your skin temperature, your heart rate, it tracks your sleep, it's waterproof, and you never have to take it off. Once I put this on, I have not taken it off. Now, Oura Ring records information and gives you insight on how to live a better and healthier life. For example, I've learned some pretty important things about myself since I've been wearing this Oura Ring. One of which is how much inactive time I have. It was pretty jarring for me, but yesterday it notified me and let me know that for 5.5 hours, I was inactive.
That's the type of data that hurts a little bit when you read it, but you need to know it.
Even down to like sleep efficiency, it gives you a score. And so my score was 86 last night, which means I'm optimal when it comes to sleep. Now, it even gets you down to how long were you awake while you were in bed? What was your REM cycle and how long was that? When were you in light sleep and deep sleep? It's trusted by everyone from the NBA to our favorite creators. Another thing that's amazing is I've been wearing this thing all day, all night. I slept in it. I wear it in the shower.
Yeah, I've heard about it. You've been telling me.
I've been telling you all about it all day. I've only charged it once and it still has 80% battery. So thanks to Aura Ring for sponsoring this episode. If you guys want to check out Aura Ring, the link is in the description. We met some of their team members this week. Super awesome company and really enjoying my time so far with the Aura Ring. And I think you guys will too. So check out the link in the description. Back to the episode.
Let's start with some context on Clubhouse. It is a live audio only app that operates a lot like a conference or a panel, like you would see at South by Southwest. People have a discussion and then audience members can basically raise their hand, get up on stage, the virtual stage, and ask a question.
We've been in Clubhouse rooms with Mr. Beast, MKBHD, Brian Armstrong of Coinbase, and we've even hosted our own. It's a really cool opportunity to be live. You know, you get to have this unfiltered conversation. But as a consumer, I'm not really like that avid of a user because one of the issues, at least personally, I face is that I open the app and I don't know what to listen to. Unless it's someone I know, I don't just casually go and listen to live audio.
As consumers, we're at a point where we want to watch something or listen to it on our own time.
Yeah.
That's the way we operate now. If you don't operate that way, you have to be very clear about your messaging and your programming. Your shows have to be really good. And that's what's going to save Clubhouse. Show development. I would say it's the same for Reels. It's the same for Twitter Spaces. Any of these new platforms, you have to have really good shows. You need to give creators and audiences an example of what the best looks like so that other creators can aspire to be that and so that audiences know what they're getting on that platform. And the answer for Clubhouse right now is coming in the form of new shows that are emerging on their platform, one of which is the Good Time Show, which we mentioned we were on. And I would argue the next hit show is NYU Girls Roasting Tech Guys.
This is the answer to the problems that Clubhouse is facing. It's this. this is the answer. These girls have figured it out.
Essentially, the way our room works is it's a very interactive format on Clubhouse. It's a room where people can find love. And so people in the audience can raise their hand and we get to choose who comes up. They'll pick someone that's in the audience or on stage that catches their eye that they would like to buy a virtual drink for at the bar simulation. And they tell us a little bit about themselves, ask some questions between each other. Everyone gets to watch their first awkward experience. We are kind of like the moderators letting the other person decide if they can slide into their DMs or not. This is a real situation where people are like finding people they could actually date. Like part of it's entertainment, but it really is a bar simulation. And the fact that like you don't have to come up on stage to DM someone. And so a lot of people DM in our room and it's kind of this virtual space where people are sliding into each other's DMs. It's like prospecting. It's like a new form of like finding people that you might want to talk to.
Talk to me about like the origin of this when you all got together. Was it, hey, this is going to be fun? Or did you look at Clubhouse and say, there's going to be a business opportunity on this app?
One thing that's really funny and important to mention is this all started as a joke. And we are actually a friend group from NYU. That's not a branding play. This is actually our friend group.
It kind of just like came out of thin air almost, you know, like we have really fun banter as a friend group. And I think people saw that and it kind of changed the experience for a lot of people on Clubhouse. You know, there were lots of rooms on like how to market your business and D2C tips and tricks and things like that.
The culture of Clubhouse had already been defined, but the types of rooms we were creating that were very like random. Like we'd create rooms like, is Armie Hammer a cannibal? Or like, are ice cubes practical?
The first night we ran it, Clubhouse actually shut down because Elon Musk was on the app. And so we had 900 people who were stuck in our room.
They couldn't leave. And so they just stayed. And so people were tweeting about us. And it was before we had a name. And they were tweeting things like, wow, like listening to these NYU girls roast tech guys is poetic.
I remember this night very well. And what's amazing to me is this was not that long ago.
Yeah, it was a month ago. I think it was Twitter that just like really catapulted us. I had tweeted a photo of 70 people waiting to come up on stage and it went viral on Twitter and had over 400,000 impressions on it. That was kind of when we were like, oh shit, like there's actually something here.
As soon as we blew up that night and I, you know, people were tweeting about us, I was like, okay, we have something really cool here and we have to identify what that it is. You know, we've had lots of conversations trying to hone exactly like, you know, what our value prop is and what we can offer and how we can experiment on other platforms and, you know, why people really like us and why people stay in the room for a really long time and, you know, how that all kind of plays into what the opportunity is here.
Who were some of those people that you first started to notice were coming into the room? Like, were there certain people where the eight of you were texting each other being like, okay, this is insane. We just started doing this.
I would say Cody Poe was really early. He jumped in and we like brought him up and we were like, roast us, Cody. And he was like, Lydia, you suck as a DJ. And we were all like...
I think what's really interesting is the breadth of different kinds of people that come in. We have TikTok stars. We have founders of large companies like Twitch. We have huge DJs like Diplo. And I think that kind of all plays into the excitement in our room and the spontaneity and the butterflies that people feel when they're sitting in the audience. Because it's kind of like, what's going to happen next?
It's very quick. It's very fast. And there's always fun people dropping in on stage.
It's like a very savvy storytelling tactic that Colin and I talk about all the time. Our job as creators is to constantly build tension and then release tension and do that at disproportionate levels to keep you watching or listening. What you guys are doing is like creating so much tension in the room of what you just said, who's gonna pop in? What's this person gonna say? Are they gonna be successful? Like some of my favorite stuff is when someone's just pitching their business and you like cut them off and kick them out. Like I love that feeling of how cutthroat you guys are.
I think that in our friend group, everyone's like pretty ruthless with each other already. And then the size of the room didn't really affect that. It was like, we just kind of, it started small. And so we joke, like, don't look down. Like, we don't even like think about how many people are listening. We're just like talking at this point. Like the audio is like a very much like, you feel very comfortable being yourself, I think.
How do you feel about some of the comments around like Clubhouse having an interesting problem? Why did you decide to make it like a program that was available on certain days at certain times? Like, how did you get into appointment listening? How did you figure out that that was the right move? And do you think that Clubhouse in general is still tough to navigate? Or what do you think of the platform?
I think in terms of the fact that it's live, it's like television, you own your hour. And like we started doing it at this time and it was like people would know to come back at that time because NYU girls were roasting tech guys at 7 p.m. PT. When we first started, I think there were like 8 million weekly active users. And then like within 2 weeks, there were like 11 million weekly active users. So we were like, it's growing really fast. We have to do this more than once a week. And we have to just keep getting new people as they come in, because they're going to come in and they're going to look for something interesting and they're going to jump around and then they're going to like have fun in our room. And so that was very intentional in terms of just cadence and structure and like consistency.
You guys are on the cutting edge of this new type of content and pioneering what it means to build a career or build a business on top of Clubhouse. I think what's interesting is it does fit into the broader creator economy or what we'll call attention economy, where it's just like you're able to capture attention. Now the question is, what do you do with it? Last question for me, where is NYU Girls Roasting Tech Guys a year from now, March 2022? Where is this company?
I hope that our distribution on other platforms becomes a lot larger. Like, I hope we're able to not only have a Clubhouse show or some kind of live show, but also have some kind of YouTube video follow-up and, you know, just kind of like experiment with different platforms. I hope that we have a really fun Twitter presence and that we really just grow our brand as being like smart, fun girls who, you know, love to engage with other people and have a really good time doing it. Everybody has careers that are in tech and business and marketing and advertising. And I don't think anybody, you know, was like, I see this for myself as a career. But I think something that we can all relate to is that, you know, we love attention. Who doesn't like attention? And so, you know, I think everybody has kind of gotten this attention and they're like, this is really awesome. And, you know, what can we make out of this?
We've created this space for really good stories, and stories make amazing content. And it's like, how can we get each of those stories in the format that's right for them? Whether it's those leader storylines of dates, whether it's like funny things that happen on the show and like how do we recap it properly, like Sarah was saying. But yeah, I think there's an opportunity to really expand the brand and just like bring a lighthearted, funny, like female first thing into the culture. And I think that like we somehow leaned into this weird like simp thing that like seems to kind of be staying. I don't know. What's so funny about it is how respected it is when we're doing it. Like no one is really like not respecting us in this. And so I think that's going to help us grow also.
You guys are a true embodiment of the future of content creators and your approach to it. And I think we're excited to help tell the story and I think inspire this next generation of creators to take some of what you guys are doing and use it as a roadmap.
Thank you so much for saying that. Seriously, this is so cool. So excited to be a part of this.
Okay, so what is the X factor here when you think about this show and like why we're so excited about it is because these girls are operating as writers, producers, development executives, brand builders, and talent.
And once they realized they had something interesting on their hands, they accounted for all of those right from the start. It was like, we need this, 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 and that.
And like from the get-go, they have a website with email capture. They have a brand that looks clean. Like you even think about us, right? Like the website and packaging has been something that's sometimes an afterthought and something that we have to work on is brand building. And so I think the conversations we've been having a lot internally is that creators are now small business owners. Like the concept of just like influencer is likely starting, we're kind of moving on from that. And this is the future where it's let's build a brand.
I think the takeaway for creators is about finding where you can be unique. Because if you can sink into a unique value prop on a platform, that's when you're going to get distribution. And that's what happened with the NYU girls. They were unique. They were doing something different. And then they realized, okay, we have something. We have attention. That's when they turned all the lights on. And I think we're going to see a lot of young creators starting to follow that roadmap of we have branding. We have our own management. We have our own writing. We have our own producing. We are an entity that's ready to go the moment the light switch turns on that we have something interesting.
Now, the reason why programming and all these roles matter, I was thinking about this morning that imagine if you turned to the Kardashians when they were starting their reality show and you're like, here's the cameras, you guys just make the show. It would not be that interesting. What makes that show is that there's producers, writers, development executives, showrunners, brand builders all attached to that show to make it interesting. Same with The Real World or any other reality show, right? And so I think the internet has now just democratized the opportunity, obviously, to break into entertainment. And now that the space is maturing, the opportunity is actually to build your own franchise.
And we talk with Sarah and Devin about this, but they are building a roadmap now for what it looks like to build a business off of Clubhouse, what it looks like to be successful. And that's what is essential for these platforms to have happening. Because if they don't, other creators don't know what to do there.
On that point, why did TikTok have so many stars? It's because they provided guidance. You open up the app and you immediately have guidance. Do this trend, you know, use this sound. And it's just like, I open up the app and I'm like, okay, you at least gave me a starting point to figure out what I'm supposed to make. And then the For You page is like feeding you content that's successful. And you're like, oh, okay, I get it. I'm starting to learn. So you start to realize like the feed is actually education for your creators. But the issue that we're talking about is that when you open up Clubhouse right now, you're like, which one of these rooms is like the best one?
The most important job at Clubhouse, in my opinion, is the head of programming. The person or the team that is there making sure that they are building programs that people actually want to tune into that are different and unique. And could only be done on Clubhouse.
Mm, that's a really important piece. It's like, what makes this platform unique and what does programming look like? It's obvious that Clubhouse doesn't have like a unique feature. The live audio room is not a unique feature. What they have to build now is what makes a Clubhouse show. And this is one of the issues that I think we talked about with Quibi. Watching short form video was not unique. Yeah. What was a Quibi show? That was the downfall. There was no programming. You didn't understand what it meant to like, what was the culture of Quibi?
It was like, why can't I just have this on my TV?
Yeah. Or why, like, couldn't I just watch a 7-minute video on YouTube? What is this? That's the answer that all these platforms need to find is, what is Clubhouse? What is Twitter Spaces? Like, what is the programming that exists there? And who is the model creator? What is the model show?
And that's really the takeaway for these platforms. You can't just open up a new feature or a new platform without thinking really heavily about programming.
How does this differ from Clubhouse? What is the model program?
And whatever that is, like, lean heavily into that.
Yeah, and show it to me. Put it on the trending tab. Like, show it to me. Show me that I should aspire to become a Spaces creator. And what type of creator are you trying to attract? Same with Clubhouse. Like, was the Elon Musk interview the marquee piece? Is that the thing that I should be aspiring to do, is interview shows? Is it this format with the NYU girls? Like, build case studies around this and make sure to storytell around what's working on your platform so I get what I'm supposed to do over there. I understand this thing of like, let's put out technology and let's see how creators use it. But you also have to define your brand a little bit and say what it is. Final question, where's Clubhouse this time next year? Like, is Clubhouse still around? How do they stay relevant over the next year? How do they not Quibi?
Scouting really good talent and injecting capital and guidance into some of these creators so that the programming gets really good. What if someone's helping the NYU girls book crazy guests right now? Mm. Really high profile single guests who are looking to go on a date. And then can you create a video version that follows that person on the date or something like that? Like, help them build really quickly so that this becomes so valuable, and then pay them to be exclusive to Clubhouse.
That last thing you just said, I think, is really important, because what you have to remember is that over time, as if this gets really big, the NYU girls, the Good Time Show, whatever it is, you're bringing a lot of users and a lot of retention to Clubhouse. There's no monetization attached to that. You have to monetize on your own time. You have to figure it out yourself. You got to help me out if I'm bringing users to your app with programming and helping create the guiding light for other creators. Clubhouse, you got to step in and support those creators.
The same way that certain actors and directors get Netflix deals, certain creators are going to have to get platform deals.
Yes. For sure. So let us know what you all think about Clubhouse. Like, is this an app that's here to stay? What do you think about the NYU Girls Roasting Tech Guys show? Is that actually the roadmap? Is there something different? What do you think about live audio in general? And if you made it to this part in the episode, you can answer one of those questions, or you can comment something really specific that only you would know because you made it to the end of the episode. So yeah.
If you made it this far into the episode, I would imagine you liked the episode. So if you could actually go down and press the like button, we would appreciate it.
Yeah, helps us out. It's a way to support the show right now.
Also, in the last 28 days, we've grown over 10,000 subscribers. And I would imagine a lot of you are some of those new subscribers who are watching right now. So thank you for subscribing. If you haven't subscribed yet, please subscribe. We cover the creator economy to empower and educate this next generation of creators. And I think this was a perfect example. It was so amazing to be able to highlight
the NYU girls who are that next generation of creators.
Thank you to Aura Ring for sponsoring this episode. And stay tuned. We have an amazing slate of programming coming up. Make sure you're subscribed and we will see you next week. Peace.
I have a question for you guys.
Yeah, go ahead.
What are the benchmarks for us to dive into this full time? A little bit hard still to define what the business really is entirely. Like, you still are kind of figuring it out as you go. For you guys, what was it that made you guys dive in? And what have you seen with other creators you've talked to?